say about a 25-year-old girl who died? That she was beautiful and brilliant. That she loved Mozart, Bach, the Beatles.
And thus began one of the biggest box office successes of the early 70s. Love Story, copyright 1970, released December 16th, 1970. I had turned 19 years old a week before that, actually 5 days before that. So I went to see Love Story when my first year in university in that snowy winter. Probably saw it in January, because school would have been out by December 16th, my first year in university. Anyway, it was a phenomenon. It was like a Twilight size, a Harry Potter phenomenon, that sort of thing. It was huge and cost about $2 million and made something like, I think I was looking at the IMDb and I think it was like 200 million or something. I mean, it was like unbelievable return. Of course, it was Paramount Pictures, so it was probably never in profit according to their accounting methods. It has become something of a joke over the years, I think, in certain respects. I used to mock it myself, but I remember watching it again right now, how much I did enjoy it when I went to the theater. And I think a lot of that, 41 and a half years ago, is because I was first year at university. It's taking place, more than half the movie is taking place in a university milieu. You know, I went to a miniature Harvard, I went to Dalhousie University. Not quite the endowment of Harvard, nor gravitas and hey, cut it out. It was certainly not a chic, well known. Anyway, and that was a time in my life when I was dating girls and things like that, dating women, young ladies, and going to lots of parties and lots of drunks at the school, the university dances and things like this. But, you know, always thinking of wanting to have that sort of feeling of love, like in this movie, you know. And it took me, I thought there might be something odd about me, and I didn't come out for another 3.5 years after this movie came out. So, you know, in the love department, university was certainly a desert for me. So it's little things like this that would keep you going, you know, thinking, am I going to experience this? I mean, you wanted to be Ryan O'Neill if you were white. You wanted to be Ryan O'Neill. You wanted to marry Ali MacGraw. And you wanted everything else to work out except that she dies. Now, it's revealed that she's dead in the first line of the movie, so you can hardly call it a spoiler. And that's what it's about. I read the book as well. The book is about, it's so slight. I think that you could read that book in less than an hour, probably, if you really put your mind to it. And I believe the book actually came after the movie. Basically, that Eric Siegel wrote a script, and then the studio got enthusiastic or whatever, and then it became a novel that was put out, and then supposedly the movie was based on it, but I believe it was the reverse. Ali MacGraw was 31 when she made this movie, and so Ryan O'Neill would be about 29, I guess. Anyway, you know what? Seeing it again 42 years later, 41 years later, I've saw it before. I've saw it on TV in the interim, at least once over the decades. And you know what? I really enjoyed it. And I think it's extremely well made. And I shocked myself. Maybe it's because my meds have to be, maybe I have to be increase my antidepressants again or something. But it certainly struck a nerve with me. I thought it was very, very well done. And I enjoyed the little documentary, 15 minutes or something, that was done in 2000 with the director Arthur Hiller. I thought it was quite well done. Ali MacGraw is not a good actress, but she was nominated for an Oscar for this, and I think that's a lot to do with the phenomenon. But at the same time, you know, if it debuted in December 16th, it might have not even gone to wide release until after that, but and then the Oscar nods would have been out in February, so I don't know. But I guess it was really, really big at that point. And people waited in line. Some people waited hours to see it. The theaters were sold out constantly. And it's the pre-internet age. If you see this little documentary that's on this disc that I only paid $5 for, you'll understand, I think, a lot of the appeal. John Marley plays Ali McGraw's father and didn't want to do it, and was persuaded by Arthur Hiller. He actually persuaded him to do it. And it seems that Ryan O'Neill was not the first pick. The first choice was, oh my goodness, who did he say? Now I can't remember. But supposedly six actors were tested, and Michael York turned it down. I still, all of a sudden, I can't remember the first person who turned it down. And Christopher Walken was tested, and I don't know who else. Tommy Lee Jones basically made his debut. I think wasn't he Al Gore's roommate at Yale or whatever, and he plays one of Ryan O'Neill's friends in this, you know, at Harvard. And Ray Milland plays Ryan O'Neill's father and was asked if he would do it without his toupee, and he said yes. And he does so much with so little. Like, he only has a few small scenes, but he's really selling his character through the eyes and the sort of expressions he has. He's the filthy rich Oliver Barrett III. And it's not, of course, happy, as in all movies of this type where you have rich boy, poor girl, not happy with the choice, right? And basically cuts his son off, and the son, you know, has to make his way with his wife and all of that sort of stuff. So, you know, things that we've seen a lot since then. But aside from, I guess, Betty Davis and Barbara Stanwyck movies, this would have seemed pretty fresh to the audience around that time. Remember, this is a time of real, real upheaval in the movies and in American society. This is 1970. It was photographed in 69 and 70, I would assume, or early 70, because it's mostly snow scenes. And, you know, you're coming off a year after Midnight Cowboy. And then what? This gets nominated for 7 Oscars, including Best Picture. And it's a complete antithesis of what was happening with innovative cinema at that time. So I remember reading articles that it was the return to romance, and then people tried to, you know, churn out romantic movies, and then of course The Godfather came along, and Cabaret came along 2 years later, like The Godfather and Cabaret and French Connection, I believe, were all like 1972, weren't they? I mean, I saw Godfather and French Connection in the movies when they came out. I didn't see Cabaret for years later. See, I wasn't gay yet. I didn't see Cabaret until I was gay. Because you weren't allowed to. They used to check, you see. So I want to say that I don't think Ali MacGraw deserved her Oscar nomination, because she, you know, her line readings are very odd. But her physical appearance, the actual lines that she had to say, the acting by Ryan O'Neill, all of it was really, really good stuff. And I'm surprised to be acknowledging that. It certainly doesn't make me very hip to acknowledge that, but I was surprised that I actually ended up enjoying it. You know, like I thought it was going to be like a Dirty Secret or what do you call it? Not the Dirty Secret. When you like something that's off the grid, what's that expression? I think you know what I mean. I just can't think of it. That's what happens. You get older, you can't pull these things out of the air as fast as you used to. Anyway, again, I'd like to say that I really quite enjoyed it, and it's one of the reasons I wanted to see Harvard University when I went to Boston in 1975. I went to Harvard Yard and all of this. It's because of this movie. It made such an impression on me when I saw it the first time. Her death scenes, nothing is extended too much, so it's not too bad. It's not that sad, if you know what I mean, even though it sets it up at the beginning. And in retrospect, seeing it again 41 years later, I'm telling you that I actually bought the love story between those two, that it seemed real, which I'm very surprised about, you know, after having lived all these years. And for those of us who have had several loves in our lives, when you're young and you're in love, it's nice that if you can relate to it at all. Most of us will have more than one love, you know, and we don't usually have the one from high school, and it takes us until we're 80. It takes us through life like that. But I remember how wonderful it was to be young and in love, and I didn't settle down till I was 30, and I was in love many times before that. I'm not actually a cynic, you know. I just play one on YouTube. I'm a romantic, if anything. You know, a kind of a skeptical romantic or a romantic skeptic, and you know, I never quite give everything at first, you know. But anyway, I recommend this. I think. It's not of the maturity of Sunday Bloody Sunday, which I talked about last week. That's from 1971. That's only a year later. That's a completely different kettle of fish. There's no homosexuals in this movie that we know of. And during one of the hockey playing sequences, I noticed that one of the players yells at another player, "Faggot." Well, that is still going on in hockey, and don't think I ever noticed that in the movie, the two or three times that I've seen it over the decades, you know. So, you know, because it was always on TV, you see it in passing. So it was a very white movie, very WASPy. I didn't see any black people in it, and I guess that wasn't unusual when a romance, a movie set in Boston and New York, and it was all very white. Anyway, Michael from Red Chair Diaries, and oh, the music by Francis Lai, L-A-I. It's a wonderful score. And I remember Andy Williams, a middle-of-the-road singer, probably like 85 or something, now he's still living. Had a huge hit with that, with the theme from Love Story, because I don't know if they're still doing it, but it was very common that big movies had lyrics written for them, and you wouldn't hear it in the movie, but then a song would come out. Like, so this one was called, "Where Do I Begin?" And I remember the lyric is something like, "Where do I begin to tell the story of a love, blah, blah, blah." And I don't remember the rest of it, but it was a huge hit. And those days, even with the Beatles and the Rolling Stones and that, radio still was middle of the road and played music like that, you know, AM radio. Anyway, that's about it. Michael from Red Chair Diaries, and I'll see you around the tube.